Starting and that is starting. We're in there. We're good. We're working on it. Hey, everybody. How are you? Good morning. Good afternoon. Good evening. Depending where in the world you are listening from. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and it's going to be Q&A. Scroll up right there. Capture right there. How's everybody doing? Trying to get some software on a little bit early. We're gonna do a Q&A, all your dog training questions. All your dog training questions. Talk
to how's everybody doing? Tap the screen to give us some hearts. What's going on with those new hearts and whatever that is?
You can be they're called super hearts. Sort of like a tipping process.
Your advice with my stranger shy dog helped me so much. Thanks, Jeff.
Awesome. There we go.
Yep, there we go. We got it.
All right, we're in the software. How are you doing? Okay, introduction. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I am a business owner, dog trainer up in Providence, Rhode Island. I'm a balanced dog trainer. You can go to solidcaninetraining.com to learn more about me. I personally, what's that?
Yes.
Yep, you're all set. Don't touch the thing.
Oh.
Please. Nope, you just undid it.
Oh.
Please go back there. It was perfect the way it was. I personally travel the world doing dog training seminars. I'm actually going to be flying over to the UK tomorrow. I've got a seminar in Scotland, and I've got a seminar in the London area. The London area, this is the fourth location that we've had it, or where we've tried to have it at, because a bunch of haters don't want people to have access to information. That's what it boils down to. So you have a lot of folks that train with quote unquote positive reinforcement, which ironically, so do we, but they don't want people to learn the balanced approach. So they will do anything they possibly can, including make death threats, anti-Semitic remarks, lie, cheat, and steal to keep me out of there. I'm bringing my buddy Sean O'Shea. We're gonna be doing the seminar together. So it's a great opportunity for so many folks. And ironically, the seminar that they tried to shut down is fully sold out, and we are actually turning people away. So I would be doing another seminar over there, probably, definitely 2018. I'm actually going to be doing a seminar series over in the UK, I've decided that because I think people should have access to all the information out there, and then let the consumer, let them decide what they should do. All right. I'm seeing questions. Yes, I see questions, but I don't always can get to my YouTube ones. YouTube is more of like it streams, but I try to pay attention to YouTube. But most of this is done on Periscope, Newf, Vermont. All right, so here we go. Ask your questions.
8-week pup whining in crate. Do I wait her out and be patient? Trying to give structure per your advice.
No, Donna, you can actually correct an 8-week-old puppy in a crate. So first of all, what we're going to do is this. First, let's talk about the word punishment. All right. Punishment is not abuse. Let's clarify that right now. If you want to know what abuse is, I can show you many, many photos of abuse in different situations and abuse. And there's a lot of dogs that are living in shelters, in my opinion, that are actually, it's an abusive situation. So a punishment is actually fact. It's actually part of the science spectrum of dog training. We don't talk science on this show at all. But punishment is information given to your dog that takes 1 to 3 seconds and is from a calm state of mind and you're not angry, that says, I don't like that, don't do it again. And reward says 1 to 3 seconds. It says, I like that. Keep doing it again. That's how dog training is. So with an 8-week-old puppy, what you can do is you can take a bonker. This is a wrapped up towel. We'll be using this a lot. And you can just walk up to the crate and you can say no. And you can just hit the top of the crate. A lot of people are going to say, oh, the dog will be afraid of the crate. No, they won't. The dog's going to be afraid of you. No, they won't. Why? I've done it thousands of times. My clients have done it thousands of times, tens of thousands of times. We've never seen that happen. So all we have seen happen is this: dogs stop whining in crates. Now, obviously with an 8-week-old puppy, you want to put them on a very good bathroom schedule. You want to document when you take them out and what they do. But if you just took the dog out and it peed and it pooed and it goes back in the crate, it's most likely just trying to get your attention. Next.
What to do when walking dogs in heel and one tries to pee on you, correct? Very gross.
If the dog's trying to pee on you, that is disgusting. I would absolutely correct it. A lot of times when you are walking your dog, you're gonna, the dog sometimes does stop to go to the bathroom. I do let dogs do that, but I usually just designate when the bathroom breaks are by just moving them off to the side and telling them to go to the bathroom next.
Train my puppy with treats. Now as an adult dog expects treats, what do I do?
So Jason, that's the downfall of using food for training. So I don't use treats for training, I use food for training. I use the dog's daily food. We do that too. Whenever we want a dog to do something, we train them a lot of times with food, anything to motivate them. But the downfall is now they'll only do it for food. Fortunately, now you have to bribe your dog to do something when instead of being a reward. So what you can do is you can start doing variable rewards if you want to, but you're gonna have to start punishing your dog for lack of compliance. The only way to get a reliable dog, especially off leash, is punish for lack of doing a known command. So if you say sit, the dog doesn't sit, but you've done sit hundreds of times, that's when you'll have to give a remote collar stim, that's when you have to give a leash pop, something like that. The dog knows it, it's refusing to do it. Next.
Getting a Yorkie puppy next week, advice on housebreaking.
I'm not the housebreaking expert. I would suggest Googling housebreaking, but I would say please don't use pee pads or you'll be training your dog to pee and poo inside the house. Mm-hmm. What I would do is I would get in a very, very small crate and be on an incredible routine, and there's some really good YouTube videos on that. Next.
My dog freaks out on the 4th of July. How can I keep him?
You know, it's really, really hard. 4th of July is really, really hard. What you can do is you can actually punish the act of freaking out and then have the dog be quiet. So in other words, you can, say these two dogs right here were running around freaking out at fireworks or thunder or loud noises. I would correct them from doing that, and then I would put them into place and let them process it. Next.
When is it okay to take the e-collar off in the crate, or do you leave it on all the time?
If you leave it on all the time, you're gonna mess your dog's neck up. It is a training tool. It's a training tool. So I think it's important to understand if your dog has good crate manners, it comes off. If your dog's whining at night, you might need it for a little bit, but it's for during training. So what I would do is, depending on your daily schedule, but say you're home all day, wake up in the morning, put your training equipment on with remote collars, switch them around every 4 to 6 hours so they don't get pressure sore. Remote collars do not burn dogs. If any vet or anybody says that a remote collar burns a dog, that just shows you how little they know about the technology. And right from there on, I wouldn't listen to a thing they had to say about the technology. So no, you don't need to have it on at night unless your dog barks unwanted at night or whines unwanted at night or has crate breaking issues at night. Next.
E-collar doing great, dog stop reacting, but still very nervous about other dogs. What would you do now?
So Julian, what I want you to do now is I want you to do existence and advocate for the dog. So you've gotten your dog to stop all the nonsense behavior. So now what your dog is, it's in a holding pattern. So it doesn't know what to do. So what you're going to do is the best thing you can do is have it around dogs, but have it not interacting with dogs right now. That's the next step. So step one was getting rid of the nonsense. Step two is then getting the dog to exist around other dogs. And then if you make it to step three, it's interacting with dogs. But if your dog never interacts with other dogs, as long as it doesn't get into dog fights or reacts to them, who cares? Next.
Expecting our first child in December, how do we train, introduce our dog?
DJ, that is a very, very long, I've got a Periscope on that. There's a very long answer to that. You're not going to be introducing them. Don't even think about introducing them for a minimum of 6 months. What I want your dogs to do is your dog should be able to do this. See this? The place command. If these dogs are doing this not because they're my dogs. People watch my videos and they can do that in, you know, a week's time. The place command is going to be your magic command when it comes to baby stuff. What I want you to do is I want you to start playing baby sounds as well. I want you to have your dogs to be able to have good manners. So if your dogs are rushing the door, they should stop. If they're rushing at windows, they should stop. If they're jumping up on counters, they should stop. If they don't listen to basic household commands, train them to do that. I want your dogs crated up at night, crated when you're not home. I want your dogs out of the bedroom. That's how we're going to start. Next.
4-month-old Aussie is fully off-leash trained, but goes up to strangers when I'm talking on the phone.
So you have a 16-week-old dog, fully off-leash trained. That's extremely impressive for a 16-week-old dog to be off-leash trained. What's going to happen eventually is your dog is going to blow you off. Your dog is going to blow you off, and this is the start of it. This is the start of it. So, so when I say off-leash trained, if your dog was chasing a deer, would it turn and come back to you, which would be really, really impressive. All right. Really impressive. So that's what's really, really good, is at least you've got a good foundation. So I would keep your dog on a leash right now and prevent it from going up to strangers. Because what's going to happen is you will stop being relevant, and then all of a sudden other people will be relevant, and that's when your dog's going to start walking away from you. Next.
Hello, I got divorced a year ago, and I'm wondering if it's best to have the dogs not see him.
Absolutely, Jill. Absolutely. Shared custody of dogs is a terrible idea. Next, have him get his own dogs. There's millions of dogs killed in shelters every year. There's so many great dogs that are up for adoption. Shared custody of dogs is not a good idea. Next.
I can't seem to get a good working level. I put the longer prongs on the e-collar, but no luck. Advice.
So, Angie, what I want you to do is make sure that there's a good contact from on skin, remote collar to skin. And I want you to make sure that the dog, it's on the dog there. Make it super snug. So many people make it so you can turn the collar around like this. That means it's not snug enough. So make it really, really snug. Then what I want you to do is I want you to start at 2, go to 4, go to 6, go to 8, go to 10. Look for muscle stimulation, look for eye blinking, look for ear twitching, look for forehead crinkling, look for something like this. But if you see the muscle moving, that's your working level. Next.
My dog gets very excited when I let him off place. Is there a way to keep him calmer?
Sure. What I want you to do is I want you to have place, and then the release command, have the dog on a leash so the dog can't go speeding off. Next.
Hi, Linda and Jeff. Huge thumbs up for your UK visit. Smash it. We need you.
Awesome. I'll be going over there with Sean O'Shea. Having a great time. We leave tomorrow. Next.
Hey, Jeff. Dog goes frantic with whining and anxiety with high-level correction when he misbehaves.
So just remember, a remote collar, you still have to teach the dog what to do with a remote collar. It's remember, remote food doesn't train dogs. Remote collars don't train dogs. Leashes don't train dogs. What trains dogs is dog training. And when I say stuff that, like, food doesn't train dogs, people be like, oh yes, it does. No, it doesn't. Shove food in front of your dog's face and say, roll over. Say, do a handstand. Say, do a backflip. All dogs are capable of doing that. Most dogs are, but the food doesn't make them do that. Training makes them do that. So the remote collar, you still have to teach the dog what the correction means. So keep the dog on a leash and give it some guidance for the first few times. Next.
How can I fix possession issues? Crate aggression, resource guarding, growling, and plays at passersby.
Joe, remote collar punishment. I've got videos on it. Next.
Move to new home. One of my dogs having a hard time adjusting. Very skittish, fast movements, cowering.
So,
that's it.
Okay. So what I want you to do is move. A dog moving is really difficult to do for a lot of dogs. Tons and tons of structure with your dog. Lots of structure with your dog, and what else is it doing? I'm telling you, they're skittish. And then crate your dog at night, crate your dog during the day, but also give your dog something to do. Give your dog something to do. All right, next.
He goes frantic when I go into the paddock to get horses, and I leave him down outside.
So what you have to do is you have to work on space and time. I would have somebody outside helping you. Have somebody outside helping you, holding the leash, keeping the dog into a down. That's how you're going to transition that. Next.
What behavior would you use the act of God correction?
Stormy, act of God correction is any life-saving thing that I'm trying to do. So act of God correction is the highest correction on the remote collar. I talk about this often. Getting into the trash, counter surfing, getting into the litter box, fence fighting, getting into the dishwasher. Those are some of the things that I would do act of God corrections on. Eating fabric articles, things like that. Next.
How to introduce high prey drive GSD to new foster kittens? That's a
15-minute answer. I made a video on that. We had a cat and a chicken at the last seminar in Spokane, Washington. There's something called crittering, and you can also do avoidance. What I would do is you want to eliminate arousal. So in the house, you don't want the dog aroused. What you can do is you can have the little kitten inside of a little cat carrier, and then you can start getting your dog to come up to the cat, bring your dog back. Come up to the cat, bring your dog back. Have the dog stay in place, and if the dog shows any sort of arousal, you can use a bonker. So you would say no, wait 1 to 2 seconds, which is called a latency period, and then throw this onto the dog. You're hitting the dog in the head. If anybody has a hard time with a towel being thrown at a dog's head, but they for some reason don't know, it's like we're trying to prevent a cat from dying. So next. There's way more to it. That's literally a 15-minute answer. Next.
Is that Anzio,
yeah.
So Anzio from Midtrain today. He's doing great work. John is awesome. So happy with progress.
Yep, awesome. Great to see. Thanks for the feedback.
Dogs know
Hold
what
on,
you
honey, nobody can hear.
Oh, sorry.
I can't hear.
You're just holding. Oh. Okay, ready?
Yep.
Dogs know when they have e-collar on. When off, they act up. When on, they're angels. Bonkers, bonker only?
No. The dogs are being tower smart. So just do a better job training. So I didn't mean that as an insultive way. But what I want you to do is, how long have you been working on with the remote tower? Does the dog understand what the word no means? Chances are your dog doesn't understand what the word no means. So the word no should mean something with or without a collar on. So if you've actually loaded the word no, just like, you know, when we train with a clicker, we load the clicker, we have to teach the dog what the clicker means. It means yes, it means food will be, you know, food was going to be happening after you hear the click. No means there's going to be a punishment afterwards. So the dog needs to understand what the word no means. So what I suggest is having your collars on all day, switching sides, running your dog through the commands. Absolutely set your dogs up for something that they're going to struggle with, and make sure they understand what the word no is. So it would be no, and then a high stem on the collar, depending on what they're doing. Next.
Dog was terrified of e-collar. With your guidance, working him at the beach, which he loves, amazing.
Awesome. Proud of you.
My dog will pee right away when I take her out, but not poop. How do I get her to poop right away?
So there's a couple of tricks you can do for poop. What you can do is you actually can take a soft. First of all, maybe the dog doesn't have to poop. Think about that. Dogs pee way more frequently than they poop. So it's obviously, if your dog's pooping in the house, then that's a problem. But if your dog's not pooping in the house or pooping in their crate, they probably don't have to poop. So I don't know, if your dog doesn't poop right away, it might not have to poop right away. So just figure out what your dog's schedule is and mark it on an Excel spreadsheet, their pee and their poop protocols, and then you'll get a better idea what it is. But if your dog hasn't pooped for a couple of days, that's another issue. Next.
Amazed of how many people are reaching out and asking about the e-collar. They don't know what it is.
No, a lot of people don't know what shock collars are, remote collars are. I've been talking about them very, very loud and clear for over 10 years, since when my radio show actually started. I'm a huge advocate of remote collars. I'm a huge advocate of training with them, punishing with them, using it for close distance obedience, far away distance obedience. It's a fantastic tool. It's one of the best tools out there to train a dog. We use it for fear, anxiety, basic obedience, advanced obedience, and then we also use it for obviously punishing bad behaviors. She poops if I let her off the leash right away. Okay, thank you. Then this is what you're going to do. Put her back in the crate. Put her back in the crate. Go back to, you don't get any freedom until you poop. That's what you're going to do. Next.
Nick, my hair is tucked behind my ears. Thank you for the compliment on my collar.
Awesome. Next.
And I think I might do a big chop, actually.
Awesome.
What would you do for nervous peeing? I don't come across dogs that do it much.
I don't, Scott, I don't come across, dogs that have nervous pee as well. I'd actually rather work with a biting dog, to be honest with you. So what I would do is this. With nervous peeing, I would do lots of confidence build, basic obedience, confidence building stuff. Also keep your tone down, keep everybody's tone down as far as their voice and their energy. And you can do trick training. That's about all you're gonna get right out of me for nervous peeing right now. Next.
Do you just continue to work them for their food to build confidence and a new association?
You can do that, yes. Next.
Hi from Spokane Valley. Great seminar this past weekend.
Thank you, Jean.
Thank you so much. The big thing around here is puppy Prozac and meds. Your opinion, please.
The big thing across the country is puppy Prozac. I would say 99.9% of the dogs don't need puppy Prozac. What I would do is I would never go to your vet for obedience obedience advice. And I would absolutely in the United States, because that's what the market I'm familiar with as far as the term veterinary behaviorist. I would absolutely not go to a veterinary behaviorist ever. They're the closest thing to a snake oil salesman that there is. Next.
Thank you for the e-collar help in Spokane. It's working.
Awesome, Billy Joe.
Billy Joe.
Next.
Hey, Billy Joe. It's my first week of prong collar training. Is it okay to still use food for the first week?
You can use food for quite some time if you want to, yes. You can always pair food. Next.
Best way to stop a male dog from trying to dominate my other dog.
That's a relationship that you're having in your house. I mean, you set the rules. So what you could do is, you depends on what the dog is doing. If the dog's following the other dog around the house, pushing the dog away from resources. If your other dog is lying down and the other dog always wants to go over to it and try to bully it away, there's something called dressage. You can use a remote collar and just tap the remote collar, stim, say, hey, cut the shit. You're being a pain in the ass. What you can also do is you can use your dressage whip. Dressage whip is a long whip with a little bit of an 8-inch drop. Yes, you can give your dog a little bit of a swat on the ass. Remember, the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. And people can yell and scream and call it 30-year-old stuff and call it abusive, blah, 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 blah. But you're not doing the work. You're not doing the work. And you're not working with challenging. And I'm very outspoken about that because people like myself are getting threatened on a daily basis, and my colleagues have been threatened on a daily basis by a bunch of keyboard warriors saying that you can use positive reinforcement only to train anything with a dog. And I want people to know it's an outright blatant lie, and it's time to stand up. Right. It's impossible to stop an unwanted behavior unless there is a punishment component. And if people don't understand that, they don't understand what dog training is. But they throw science at you. They just don't get it. And I'm outspoken about it. And I know I'm going on a ramble right now, maybe because I'm about to go over to the UK, where I was threatened with my life, threatened with my safety, called a greedy Jew, tried to shut down all my seminars. It's costing me lots of money to redo all of these seminars. And you're keeping people away from learning about how to actually train a dog. What a disservice that is. So maybe I am going to go on a little bit of a rampage today. And I apologize if it comes off angry, but it's passionate beyond comprehension. The passion I have to be able to help people that are struggling with their dogs. Could you imagine that? People don't want you to know that there's another way to train a dog other than with positive reinforcement. And we use positive reinforcement every day of the week. We probably use more positive reinforcement than positive reinforcement dog trainers do. Why? Because we're training more dogs. Next.
When using a prong collar, when do you give info versus a correction?
Whenever I'm doing any type of training with any type of dog, I start out in kindergarten. And I help the dog fully understand what is expected before I punish them. Now, if a dog jumps up on me, punishment. Bites me, punishment. Barks excessively, punishment. But if a dog doesn't understand what I want, enforcement. I'm trying to shape the behavior. Next.
A pure positive trainer told my friend to use blinders to help reactivity. I LOL'd and showed her.
Okay, so whoever that dog trainer was, was probably a certified accredited trainer. Can you tell the kids I need something to drink, please? Cup of water. Thanks. Coffee and water. Whoever that trainer was, okay, is a charlatan. They're a scam artist. Put blinders on your dog to get them to stop being reactive? That's got to be one of the stupidest, most unethical things that I've ever heard of. Sorry. And I'd like to know, if all these people out there that are proclaiming that they're doing it, science, what page was that on? What page of the documents of the research is that on? B. Gates. Next.
Dog knows e-collar place, breaks commands sometimes. Should I high-level correct? If so, how high?
What I want you to do is if the dog absolutely knows place and the dog is breaking place, I want you to correct for non-compliance, but have the dog on a leash so that it knows, so it understands how to go back. Remember, you've got to educate how to punish a dog just like you have to educate how to reward a dog. Remember, just pushing a button is not going to get the dog to jump back on a place. Okay, it's actually called punishment. Fin Fan, the word's punishment. Punishment is not a bad word. Okay, punishment is not abuse. The actual word is actual punishment. We can call it a correction if you want to, but it's actual punishment. So, next.
Where in the home is the best place for my dog's crate? Out of my sight? Within my sight?
I just put it in the main room, living room, family room if you want to. Just down in your bedroom. Get out of your bedroom. Next.
I always say kitchen just because it's easier to clean.
Yep, next.
My 6-month-old dog growls and bares teeth at strangers out of fear. Do I correct this and how?
I mean, 6-month-old dog growls and bares teeth at strangers out of fear. Yes, you do. You punish it. You absolutely punish it. And a lot of people are going to say, well, this is the, well, first let me just put this into context. If your dog is next to you and people are rushing your dog and the dog is growling and showing teeth, the first thing you have to do is say, let me advocate for my dog and tell those people to back up. Tell those people to back up. But if your dog is sitting there, standing there, and somebody walks up to you to talk to you and that dog growls, absolutely punish it. What would that look like? Leash correction, bonker, remote collar stim. And all the information, and you're going to read over and over and over and over again, no, don't do that. Have the people give treats. They're going to get their hand bitten off. That's step two. Step one is stopping the bad behavior. Step two is then, yes, you can do treat, click, click, treat, click, treat, click, treat. That's what we do. Stop the bad behavior. Then tell the dog what you want next. But if the dog growls and you display food, guess what you're teaching that dog what to do? Growl. Think about this. Like, understand learning theory. No, no, no. This is what's taught all the time. Well, if your dog's growling at food, have them come up and throw food at your dog. What? That's how I train a behavior. That's how you would train your dog to growl. This is common sense. No, no, they'll have a better association with the human. No, they won't. You trained your dog to growl. Growl, reward shows up. No, growl, punishment shows up. Yes, next.
My dog is overly attached to my girlfriend's dog, whines, doesn't listen when he's around.
My dog is, hold on, that doesn't make sense. My dog is overly attached to my girlfriend's dog. Oh, the dog, dogs. Your dog has anxiety issues with a missing dog. What I would do is this: keep the dog separate. You have to make sure that they're, start training the dogs how to be separate, okay? Train the dogs how to be separate. So what I would do is make sure they sleep in separate areas, or when they're, and you can also punish the whining. Punish the whining, yes.
I have, I have e-collar trained dog and I still have questions.
Yep.
Is it a constant learning experience?
Kid Canada. It is. Dog training is always learning. You're always gonna learn something new. I mean, there's some basic things that we stick to. We don't change our story on it, but you know, you can always learn little nuances. Next.
Puppy screams all day when left in kennel. When we come home, his paws and face are soaked with drool.
Richard, get a bark collar. Get a bark collar for your dog. Obviously, okay, this is a great segue into this. Okay. You hear me talking about punishment a lot. If you're brand new to my show, you'd be like, what does this guy do? Punish his dog all the time? 9 out of 10 times, I reward my dogs. But nobody's asking me how to train something. Everybody's like, listen to the narrative. Everybody's asking me how to stop a behavior. And the only way to stop a bad behavior is through punishments. But now's a great time to also explain a little bit of the work we do. We're humongous advocates of nutrition. We're huge advocates of exercise. We're huge advocates of socialization. We're big advocates of basic obedience and advanced obedience. We're huge advocates of stopping unwanted behavior. But the general conversation of a lot of my show is, how do you stop fill in the blank? That's why. All right, next.
What do you think about the bungee collar for e-collar? Is it better for the neck for a long time?
The great thing about the bungee collar, the great thing about the bungee collar is this: you get a better fit. That's the best thing about it. It's not a neck issue, it's a better fit issue. Next.
How do you use e-collar for anxiety? You mentioned that.
Christy, it's the best thing for anxiety. We use low levels for anxiety. I demonstrated it at all my seminars. This weekend at my seminar, I demonstrated in front of, I think there was 40 people at my seminar in Spokane, Washington this weekend. Dogs anxious in the crates. So imagine if you've got anxiety. They actually use this for human anxiety. So imagine they've got it for anxiety. So the dog is always on edge. They're nervous. They're spinning around in their crate. They're always up like this. They're reacting to everything. Their mind is racing. What you do is you use it in lower levels, and it's almost like someone put their hand on their shoulder. your hand on your shoulder and says to calm down. So what you do is called fishing. Which level do I need? Do I need it at a lower level continuous, a lower level momentarily? Do I go up a little bit? Do I go down a little bit? How do I get my dog to be comfortable in the crate? And it's all done with no words. You can even do it from another room. Next. And some people say they've shut down the dog. They're full of shit. You know why they're full of shit? Because they've never done it. It's called their opinion. It's not based on fact. So the fact is, we've done it with thousands of dogs. Our clients do it with dogs. We make, you know, we do it all the time. Next.
Can e-collars be used on very small dogs?
Yes, they can. Next.
How young can I start place command with pup? 10 weeks, 12 weeks?
10 week, Donna, 10 week old pup, we do with food all the time, but don't worry about duration. So what you do with it, I've got this little routine that I do, come, sit, break, and then I can do come, place, sit, break. I've got a video on that. It's literally done off leash with puppy, use the dog's daily food, and don't worry about duration. The dog runs to you, it sits, it gets food, you cross the room, it runs to you again. It's a lot of fun to do, and then you can also include place with it, and then eventually include down with it. It's a great way to put your dog through lots and lots of drills. I've got a great video on that on my YouTube channel.
My GSD barks at other dogs at the dog park when another dog tries to get the ball or water.
Dre, stay out of dog parks. They're the most toxic, dangerous places for a dog ever to be. They're just bad. Dog parks are horrific. You don't know what diseases dogs have. You don't know what behaviors dogs have. You can't correct any of their dogs. I've seen too many dog fights. I've seen humans that have no clue about animal behavior. Stay out of dog parks. Next.
Thanks for the work you did.
You're very welcome, Nicole.
Hey, Steph.
Hey, Steph.
That's ridiculous. I'm sorry you have to deal with that.
Don't worry about it.
Do you have a video? I'm sorry.
No, I was just gonna say, I don't mind dealing with it. I don't mind. This is not me like, you know, look at me, da, 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 da. But I will put myself out there. You know, everybody says they love dogs. No, they don't. No, they don't. They're not dog lovers and they're not people lovers. They're not. I don't see people out there making all these videos to help people with their dogs. All these haters. I'd be more than happy to start taking some. Well, I will continue to take the hate. Go ahead.
Do you have a video of correcting fence fighting, prong working, but high level e collar escalates?
So high level e collar escalates. Number one, I don't know how high you're going. I don't know the brand of the e collar, and it might not be a strong enough e collar. And then maybe now what you have to do is you've got to go higher earlier. The first sign of the dog rushing towards the fence. Correct high. How high? Highest possible. Next.
When I asked for guidance, vet herself told me that her dog follows her around too, and that's okay. WTF.
Like I said, don't ask vets. Do not ask a vet for dog training advice. And as long as dogs continue to carry science diet, hills, or even recommend crap food, don't ask them for nutritional advice. They had 4 hours of not even training. All the information they get about behavior is on printouts. Next.
Hey, what's up from Germany?
Hey, Germany. The gates.
That's all I have right now. It's not moving.
Okay, so relax.
Oh, there we go. We are coming to see you next year. If you return to the UK, you're my hero and dog saver.
Nick, I will be there next year. I'll be there. Yep, don't worry about it. I'll be there.
Thank you for your answer and good luck on your trip.
Thank you so much, Jeff.
What about placing dog behind fence in group class when reacting to other dogs?
Stupid thing to do, Wanda. Stupid thing to do. What that tells me is that there's a lack of skills in the dog trainer. There's a lack of skills in the dog trainer. Every dog, this is what you have to do. When you're looking for a good dog trainer, the first question you ask is this. How do you stop an unwanted behavior immediately? So the dog was probably put behind the fence because it was reactive. A bonker would have stopped the reactivity. So every seminar that I do, I've got 15 to 18 dogs all in one room next to each other lying down. It's not because I'm some miracle guru or miracle worker. It's because I eliminate the arousal in the dogs, and then I teach them what I want. And it's not just me that's doing this. Thousands of balanced trainers around the world are also doing this. You eliminate the arousal, and then you train. The problem is when you have a reactive dog and you're trying to redirect it, it's never going to work. You can fix the arousal, eliminate the arousal, eliminate the reactivity in literally 1 to 3 seconds with zero fallout. And you're going to hear a lot of stuff. Oh, no, you can't. Punishment is bad. No, it's not. Punishment's good. Give me a break. Next.
Vet sent me to appear positive, took money, time, and said that the dog needs medication. That's how I found you.
Yep. And that's the unethics of dog training right there. Charlatans. Next.
Many of these people who can't control their dog, correct their dog, won't say no to their kids either.
A lot of this stuff. Yeah. But this is the thing, Brenda, you bring up a good point, but this is the thing. In some countries, it's illegal to say no to your dog. It's one thing that people won't say no, but do you know that in Sweden, you can't say no to your dog? In Sweden, you can't have a dog in a crate. In Hillsboro, Florida, in Denver, Colorado, in New York State, in Toronto, they're trying to pass laws that you cannot say no to your dog. These are not prong collar, remote collar laws, by the way. These are you can't say no to your dog laws. That's the way the law is written. You cannot say no to your dog. Those are the laws that are being passed. So for people out there that you might be against prong collars and remote collars, that's fine. But what's also written into the law is you can't say no. Remember that. So if you vote on one of these laws, if you're for one of these laws, what you're also agreeing to, all right, is you can't say no to your dog. Next. And it's important to allow owners to make choices on how they train their dogs. Nobody's forced to use any of these training tools, but an owner should have a choice on what tools they use. Sorry, next.
It works. Replaced active God level aggression with come sit. Single correction. Dog now sits instead.
Michael, excellent.
Advocate and punish worked for me.
Excellent.
Oh no, Jeff, all the positive peeps say never to correct a growl,
What they do is they always say never to correct a growl, and this is why. If you correct a growl, the dog will never give a warning sign before the bite. Now, you have to put this into context though. You have to put this into context. So let's say a child runs up to a dog and the dog growls. Say a child runs up to a dog and gets in the dog's face. Now, what I would do is correct the child. Correct the child first. So there's nobody's putting things into context usually. But if somebody's walking by and your dog growls, you correct that growl. The dog, if you correct the growl, the thought of growling, the thought of biting, you correct it all. Next.
A camera just went floating up in the hearts. What's that about?
Somebody did a screenshot.
Join Periscope to follow you outside Facebook and YouTube. Love you.
Oh, guys. Shelby. Awesome. Thank you.
I saw you use it for anxiety last summer in Philly. Amazing.
Yep.
Getting much better with timing corrections and being firm with my dog, seeing a good change.
Good. And you know, when you say staff, awesome. And you know what? It's not just being firm. It's being fair. It's being fair with your dog. It's called boundary setting. So many people have got issues with boundaries. Human issues with boundaries, right? They can't say no to their friends. They can't say no to their parents. They've got issues. They've got issues with boundaries. They don't know how to set personal boundaries. It's the same with dogs. They don't know how to set boundaries with dogs. Next.
People need to get that. The balance is important.
It's always about the balance. Always about the balance.
Sorry if I type gibberish. I have phone in pocket while listening. Please don't block me.
Sean, the fact that I read that, I didn't block you.
First day with prong. Dog learned dance, sit, structured walk, down, in place. It works.
Good job, Shelby.
I know I wish Periscope would let you close the app and still listen.
Yeah.
Puppy growls and nips at vet. She bares teeth and then lays on ground and refuses to move. Help.
The puppy growls and the nips at the vet. She bares teeth and then lays on the ground. Your dog is stressed. Your dog is stressed. So what I would do is, this is the thing with that. I need more context on that, but historically what happens is vets usually get too excited. They get too excited. The thing is, you really can't punish your dog in front of the vet. The vet usually freaks out. So what I would do is I would role play that a lot. A lot of times, though, vets and vet techs, they get too overly excited with the dog. They get the dog too overly stimulated. You know, I had to take one of my dogs to the vet the other day, and I knew he was gonna growl. He's my friend, he's the dog that protects my property. And I just muzzled him up, and I'm like, my dog's gonna growl at you. My dog doesn't wanna be handled by a human being, and I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. But with a puppy, what I would start doing is I would start desensitizing the puppy to growling. And the way you're gonna do that is with clicker and food. So I want you to start touching your dog all over. There's something positive, you would click and you'd give food. So the dog starts looking forward to touching. And if there's any growling, take the barker, you say no, you bark. Great. Now, do the positive side. Does that make sense? So reward for the touching and you punish for the growling. Simple concepts. Next.
How long should session be when training a puppy?
Puppy depends on what you define on puppy. 8 to 10 week old puppy, 12 week old puppies, they should be in their crates for almost 18 to 20 hours a day, not straight, but you know, over the course of the day. You can do little 15 minute, 20 minute training sessions. Just make life all about training. Everything's training. Next.
I've been using a prong collar on my 5-month-old Dober Dane puppy for about a week. Great results.
Awesome, Catherine.
How to stop rough wrestling? Stim tends to cause roughness to escalate.
So Sean, what you might gotta do is this: what I want you to do is this. If I would use a dressage whip instead. Dressage whip, just look it up, D-R-E-S-S-A-G-E. You can get it from any CAC shop, any horse supply store. You can get it at Tractor Supply. And if it starts getting rough, you walk up to one of the dogs and just say, you know, enough, and a little bit of smack on the butt. You're not going to hurt your dog. Your dog's not going to hate you. You know, you're not going to damage your relationship with your dog. All my dogs have had little swats in the butt. Angelo, my son, has gotten spanked. Our other two kids that are still at home have gotten spanked. It doesn't, you know, there's a big difference between a well-timed, calm correction, a well-timed, calm punishment, and abuse. There is a huge difference. Next.
Maybe my dogs don't know no real well, as you said from my last question.
Possible.
When using prong collar and e-collar, which goes highest on neck?
Usually prong collar up top and remote below.
The theory sounds good, but it doesn't pan out as far as correct growl. I'm not sure what that means.
I don't know what that means either.
5-month-old doodle, prong exacerbated, leash biting, throwing itself on the ground. Too young for prong?
No, a 5-month-old dog can absolutely. So the dog is probably, that's probably just a messy middle. 5-month-old dog can absolutely have a prong collar on. What's probably happening is the dog is just objecting. A lot of dogs over object to a lot of different things. These dogs have to get put away downstairs. We have to put them away. Can you see if the girls can do that? Okay. Loaning and. And
Kira.
Ronan and
Jackie.
Yep. What's probably happening, Beth, is we got fireworks going off, and one of my dogs right now is just, we have tons of fireworks right next door to our house. He's barking at the fireworks. So how would I stop that? I can't correct him from up here. So what if I would do is I'd have a remote collar on the dog. I would correct him. Okay. So Ronan's got to get in this kennel, okay?
Sure.
Thanks. Or at least put him in his own private, in the own private yard, so he doesn't have access to the front.
Okay.
Thanks. So it's probably just a dog that's just objecting a lot. Next.
Did we do this one?
No.
Spend hundreds on dog trainer, never again. Learning more from your teaching, Skype, and Q&A.
Awesome. But Nick, just to clarify, there's fantastic dog trainers out there. There really, really is.
When strangers walk by my GSD, he growls. I say leave it, and double tap e-collar still does it.
John, don't say leave it. Say no. And go with a high correction. You might have to help. And go to a high correction. All right? Don't say leave it. Because leave it is it's almost like a redirect. It's almost like a redirect. So I actually don't want the dog to leave it. I want it to be no. So think about this. Your dog is growling at somebody, and you're saying, "Hey, what it is? There's something going on in our front yard." That's what the problem is. Yep.
Are the pawpaw out there?
I don't know. There's some nonsense going on. That's why he's barking.
Huh.
That's what it was. Anyway, it's almost like you're redirecting the dog. So it should be no stim. Next.
I have a lab and a golden mix rescue who was not socialized with other animals, was put in a cage or in the rescue.
Okay, so first of all, let's forget that it's a rescue. Okay?
Oh, a cage or doghouse and has anxiety, fear of makes.
Okay, so you got, okay, first of all, what I want you to do, who's that, Penguin? So Penguin, let's do this. First off, and I'm being serious, you don't own a rescue dog anymore. You own a dog. And the reason why I say that is this. It's like saying, oh, this is my adopted child. And I think I want everybody to start having the mentality is you own a dog. So, because what's going to happen is if we use the word rescue, sometimes we feel bad if we have to punish them, if we have to be firm with them, and it's going to keep you from doing the best. So you've got a dog that's antisocial. Boom. Great. Problem. Now, solution. So what I want you to do is this, is I want you to get this dog, I want you to find some sort of structured socialization. Structured socialization, which is different than doggy daycare. Structured socialization. And I want you to advocate for your dog. Stay out of dog parks. Then what I want you to do is, we've done some videos on structured socialization. I'll have my team at the training center do a Periscope on socialization tomorrow, or maybe if I'm at the training center tomorrow for a little bit, I'll do a quick Periscope on structured socialization. So I can, I'll do it tomorrow. I'm gonna do a structured socialization on Periscope tomorrow, and you're gonna watch how I do it. But what you're gonna do is you're gonna advocate for your dog. Don't let dogs run up to it. Keep your dog. Keep your dog on a leash, and I want you to advocate for your dog. So what I want you to do is, I want you to have your dog around other dogs, but not interacting. That's step one. That's step one. Next.
When you say high correction, also leash pop, or just the e-collar high stim?
It's so much easier just to use a. It's so much. You're welcome, Penguin. It's so much easier just to use a remote collar. Next.
How do you get a puppy through fireworks? He does not react to thunder or lightning.
So, Catherine, cool that there's no thunder and lightning. What I was telling, I sort of answered this before. So, when the fireworks go off, you stop the nonsense. So, here's a good example. Say your dog is running around and it's going nuts with fireworks. You punish that. You punish the act of going running around, then you put your dog into place. So, place would be something like this. Right. So we don't know if those dogs like fireworks or not, but all I know is that they're listening. They're not reacting to fireworks. So if they're stressing out, which they're not doing, these two dogs actually are not gunshots and fireworks and thunder. They've both been proofed off of. But what it is stop the frantic behavior. Now go lie down and we're going to work through it together. But don't allow the dog to be frantic. Next.
No balance trainers in my area, all opposed prong, which we use.
Awesome. Why don't you become a dog trainer? Seriously, Nick, become a dog trainer.
Yeah. I have a male rat terrier. He pisses everywhere. Help me, please. Thank
so, Mrs. C, so what I want you to do is stop giving your dog so much freedom. So your dog has, first of all, check for a UTI. But it's probably not medical. It's most likely behavioral. Stop giving your dog so much freedom. Your eyes should never be off that dog. So when you've got a dog that goes to the bathroom all over your house, you have to, it's your fault. It's actually your fault. Your dog has too much freedom. Create your dog at night. Create your dog during the day. Monitor when the dog goes to the bathroom. Okay, monitor when the dog goes to the bathroom outside, and then try to get a certain schedule up and running. All right. So what I want you to do is take it out to the same spot, have it go to the bathroom, but don't give it any freedom. That's what you have to do for now. Next.
My dog is afraid of fireworks, thunder, and really? Other loud sounds. Thunder shirt doesn't work.
I've already answered that a bunch of times. Thunder shirts rarely work. Next.
Becoming a dog trainer pro prong, none in my area either.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. It's too bad because, you know, a prong collar is just a tool. And other collars, if you're worried about it hurting a dog, most collars hurt dogs way more than prongs. Like a slip lead does, a martingale does, a flat buckle collar does. You know, harnesses are not designed for, you know, for dog training. They're designed for pulling. So it's too bad, but things are getting better. Next.
Any advice on becoming a dog trainer?
Yeah, start working with lots and lots of dogs. That's the best thing to do. So you can start working, you can find a rescue that works for lots of dogs. We do have a seminar series, but I don't do this to promote my seminars. But if you go to Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff, Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff. That's SEAN.com. You can start finding out there. And there's underneath my services on my website, Solid Canine Training, there's a link to there. We train other dog trainers around the world. Next.
Your opinion on best e-collar?
I don't know about the best, Shelby, but I like e-collar technologies. ecollar.com. Thank you. Next.
Best to stay inside with fireworks? I don't want a repeat of last year. It was yes, great for days.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Your best thing to do with your dog is keep your dog inside with fireworks. Next.
Where are you? Oh, she's
Kathy's asking. Yeah.
I have a GSD with leash aggression, but is very social at doggy daycare. She is strong.
Okay, so what I want you to do is this. It's an arousal thing. This is it. A lot of dogs are leash aggressive that are also good with dogs. Why? They want to get to the other dogs to play. That's why I never allow dogs to ever meet on leash. Never allow dogs to meet on leash. So what I want you to do is get a prong collar and teach the dog how to walk on a prong collar without any distractions. Then what I want you to do is I want you to get a bonker. Start with a bonker because you're going to get rid of the arousal. Then what I want you to do is as soon as you start, you walk outside your walk, you go outside your house, and the dog stops. As soon as that dog starts looking around like this, I want you to say the word no, wait 1 or 2 seconds, and then throw this at the dog. You're throwing it at their head. It's a towel. You won't hurt your dog. Your German Shepherd dog could probably run into a wall. My dogs have run into trees and glass doors, and they're not hurt. So what you're doing is you're technically like loading the word no. Now the dog knows what the word no means. So we do the same thing with a clicker. We have to load the clicker. Click, treat, click, treat, click, treat, click, treat. The dog's not doing anything. Why are you giving it a treat? We're teaching it what the click means. So you have to teach what the word no means. So that's why there's this, you're pairing the word no to a consequence. Then what I want you to do is you, now all of a sudden you've set the tone for the walk. Go on your walk. Now the word no has power to it. Next. That's it. It's okay. We're 51 minutes in. What time is it? It's date night anyway.
Yes. So prong collar first.
Yep. You need prong collar first. Yep. But you can also go to remote collar too. But yeah, we like the prong collar on the walks. It helps. It really helps. So tomorrow, Sean is getting on an airplane in probably about 5 hours. He's doing a red eye. He's doing a red eye into Providence. He arrives in Providence tomorrow, I think at 11. He's had a really long flight. At 3 o'clock, we head up to Boston, and we go from Boston to London, London to Scotland. And then this coming weekend, we actually start, we're doing a 2-day seminar, and then we're doing a Q&A Saturday night. On Monday, we're doing a pack walk and a barbecue. And then on Monday night, Tuesday and Wednesday, we're doing one-on-one sessions. And then we're going to London. And then in London, we're doing it all over again. And the London seminar is sold out. So all these haters, all these people that were breaking the law, were trying to keep us from doing a seminar, we're actually doing it, and it's sold out, and we're turning people away.
Near seminar from Arkansas?
Texas. Go to rvdogtrainer.com. rvdogtrainer.com. I'll be announcing some more. 2017, I think, is booked. Yeah, Florida. Yeah, we bought a house in Florida. So I'll be in Florida January and February. So we'll be in Ellington. There's a seminar in Ellington. Just go to rvdogtrainer.com. I forgot.
How to do a pack walk?
New Jersey, Providence, Rhode Island is close to New Jersey, or also you can go to Nazareth, Pennsylvania. I've got a seminar in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. So, but the Providence, Rhode Island seminar is going to be it's a 4-hour drive from you. It's well worth it. Next, I'll be in South Carolina. Go to rvdogtrainer.com, guys. rvdogtrainer.com. You can see the seminar series. See the whole seminar series. All right, I think that's it for now. I just want to thank everybody. Thanks for all the support, the wonderful kind words. Thanks for everybody that's doing all the work and kicking ass. I really, really appreciate it. If it's your first time listening to the show, you'll understand that I talk about punishment a lot. The reason why I talk about punishment is because people keep asking me, how do I stop something? And the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. You know, we obviously do a ton of quote unquote positive reinforcement. That's how we get dogs to do what we want. But to stop an unwanted behavior, there has to be a punishment component to it. My eye. Hey, Belize. Hey, I want to get down there to Belize soon. My eye is getting much, much better. I actually published the full video today. If you haven't been to my Facebook page, you can see actually the full video. And the full video, it shows exactly what I'm trying to accomplish. And in one session, it's pretty cool what we accomplished.
Hi, Heather.
Yeah.
How are you?
Sorry about your mother, Heather. Yeah. Thanks to everyone. Okay. See if you're in the UK. Oh, yeah. It'll be great. Looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to it. Should be a great, fantastic trip. Check us out on Instagram. I'll be doing Instagram stories on it. We'll be putting up short blurbs all the time on it. Sean and I'll be doing a ton of behind-the-scenes social media. We'll be doing a lot of, you know, live social media. Just lots of great stuff. We're gonna be filming a lot of this. So it should be pretty interesting. Pretty interesting tip. Yeah, clown suit with that bike. I know.
That's my worst nightmare. No.
It's true.
Not the clown suit.
Do's and don'ts of a pack walk. If you're talking about a pack walk with you handling multiple dogs, so if you're handling multiple dogs, I don't know what your skill set is. Don't let the dogs fight, and do keep them in behind you. So what I would do is I would have, you know, start out with two dogs and then do a third dog and do a fourth dog and stay within your comfort level. Stay within your comfort level. I mean, it's a great photo op to have 14 to 16 dogs on a walk. I used to do it every day on Blackstone Boulevard. Every day I used to do anywhere from 10 to 14 dogs, and I would do 3 miles every single day. Rain, you know, snow, people would stop, they'd take their pictures of the dogs, and it was pretty cool. I don't do that anymore. You do get some really good skills from learning that, but you have to be super, super careful about doing that. Now, we don't really do it because, you know, that's not really our thing. But you can learn a lot about dogs, definitely about their energy, about their breathing. You can start reading dogs really, really well. You can start making sure that you stop things before they start. But what I always say is be super cautious. Super cautious. Why? You can turn like that. And then you got yourself a pack attack. Don't put them on. Make sure every dog has its own leash. So don't put them on leash. Do not use leash splitters. Make sure every dog has their own leash. Because if you have to separate dogs, you can separate them. All right. Okay, everybody. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Madly in love with all of you. I feel honored and blessed that I can share my knowledge and that I've got people that actually listen. And take care. I'll see everybody tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Peace.